the struggle between these two concepts of freedom go on within this country and between countries. And these concepts of freedom aren't abstractions to the extent that they're rooted in the real struggle, embodied struggle, of human subjects to gain freedom. This word itself is used as a material force in the battle. If you know what I mean, when you see these struggles, you hear this word, freedom, and it's part of the struggle to announce it, that it's your aim, without necessarily filling it with content.
According to the philosopher Isaiah Berlin, there are two main kinds, positive freedom and negative freedom. Negative freedom is the freedom to do stuff unencumbered by others. So, for example, it's getting the authorities out of your life. It's living unencumbered by constraints. Positive freedom is the ability to be the master of your own actions. Often it means not being enthralled to your own desires or making decisions on a mere whim. Both kinds need to be in play in the life of an individual and a community, but getting the balance right between them isn't easy.
To look at the difference between the two, let's shift to a somewhat different area, economics, and the idea of freedom in the economic sphere, in the market. According to one view, the liberal view, freedom consists simply in people being able to do as they prefer. If I prefer to wear an orange shirt this spring, for instance, then I'm free if I can do that. If I prefer to buy a deodorant, I'm free if I can do that. And that's all that the liberal economist will ask. Are you free to choose the preferences that you have to fulfill them? But some of the more radical economists have questioned that, and they've said that's a very superficial notion of freedom. You should ask, why do you want to wear an orange shirt this season? Why do you want to use a deodorant? Why don't you accept that a certain amount of natural body odor isn't a problem or whatever? And the radical economists will say the reason is that you've been manipulated. There are people who want to make a profit out of you buying their deodorant, out of you thinking that the clothes and the colours you wore last season are no longer good enough this season. So you've been manipulated. You're not free. You have to ask not only can you do what you prefer, but why do you prefer what you prefer? Are they rational preferences? Are they preferences that satisfy your needs? Now, Hegel would have been in the latter camp. He would have said, freedom is more than just ability to follow your own caprice. Freedom must consist in fulfilling yourself as a rational individual.
There are two prominent notions of freedom in the modern West. One is that liberty is simply the absence of coercion. When am I free? When I'm not in jail. When am I free? When you get out of my way and let me do what I want. The other is that liberty or freedom is self-determination. I'm free when myself determines my actions, rather than something else determining my actions. Now, these can certainly overlap. Okay? I mean, it would seem, you know, if I'm let out of jail, now no one's coercing me, and at the same time, myself is free to determine its own actions. However, they can depart, they can diverge from each other. It's possible to follow one and not the other. We can illuminate this difference by asking a simple question. Is a rich drug addict free? I'm a junkie, that's all I want, and I have unlimited access to it, okay? So I experience no obstacles to getting what I want. Now, if freedom is simply the absence of coercion, then we must say the rich junkie is free. But we may not want to say the rich junkie is free. Some of you may say, well, that's not really freedom, is it? The question is, if we think he's not free, what idea of freedom must we be implicitly using? Okay? Now, if you don't think the rich junkie is free, you're probably saying something like, he's not because he's not himself. He's under the control of the drug. But this implies that his openly expressed desire for the drug is not the real him, not his true self. And indeed, historically, those who accept self-determination as the definition of freedom, rather than absence of obstacle, have to distinguish between a true or higher self and a false or lower self. So they can on occasion say, it looks like Cahoon is acting freely, but it's not real freedom. His lower self is getting what it wants. That's true, without obstacle. But his higher self has ceased to determine his actions. He's acting out of his lower self. Okay? For this tradition, freedom is not just absence of coercion. It's whether or the true or higher or good self acts, rather than the petty, vicious, or immoral desires within me act.
Here is a dimension of freedom that Mill's argument won't handle. It's summed up in the famous French joke. The rich and the poor are equally free to sleep under the bridges at night. One suspects such a concept of freedom is very poverty-stricken.
Isaiah Berlin lived through much of the 20th century. He saw the great tyrannies of communism and Nazism. So it's no surprise that he was a champion of individual liberty and negative freedom, and that although he valued positive freedom, he was also acutely alive to its dangers.
Positive freedom has been more perverted than negative freedom. Both can be perverted. When people talk about laissez-faire, and therefore allow little children to die in mines because their parents have a right, because they're free to let you have them, and you have a right to employ them in the way you do, that is a perversion of the notion of negative freedom. But if somebody says, I alone know what is good for you, you do not know what is good for you, and therefore I force you to do certain things which, if you were as clever as me, you would see for yourself. But if you don't see, it's because you're stupid, and I have to force you to do something for your own benefit. That is, every tyrant has said that. If negative liberty leads me to allow the poor to starve to death, that won't do. If negative liberty leads me to ignore the needs of all kinds of other people, provided I am allowed to sit in a room and listen to gramophone records and take no part in political life, that is a perversion.
The point is very important, and especially important to remember if we're going to bandy this word democracy and freedom, these words around. Because you can't have a free society that doesn't have positive freedoms for people, that doesn't enable them to exercise their freedoms.
Positive freedom has lost much of its allure in the West. Berlin worried that its notion of self-mastery, self-control, could be too easily abused and lead to states telling us how to live. But I think we may have gone rather too far and lost sight of the value of positive freedom. We need to put the two back into balance.
While it might be very difficult in practice to work out how you could have a society in which individuals genuinely realize their rational self, that doesn't mean that you've overcome the problem by the liberal laissez-faire notion. I mean, we still do have to face that problem, that people's wants and desires might be being manipulated, and to the extent that they are, it's perhaps misleading to say that they're really free.